Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sin. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Be a rock of refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. For you are my rock and my fortress, and for your name's sake, you lead me and guide me. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. Make your face shine on your servant. Save me in your steadfast love. Refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. For you are my rock and my fortress, and for your name's sake, you lead me and guide me. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above, and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Thank you.
us pray. O Lord, mercifully hear our prayers, and having set us free from the bonds of our sins, deliver us from every evil. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Old Testament reading for Quinquagesima is from Isaiah chapter 35. Strengthen the weak hands and make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who have an anxious heart, be strong, fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance, with the recompense of God. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap like a deer and the tongue of the mute sing for joy. For waters break forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. The burning sand shall become a pool and the thirsty ground springs of water. In the haunt of jackals where they lie down, the grass shall become reeds and rushes. This is the word of the Lord. You are the God who works wonders. You have made known your might among the peoples. You with your arm redeemed your people, the children of Jacob and Joseph. The epistle is from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways. For now, we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. So now, faith, hope, and love abide, these three. But the greatest of these is love. This is the word of the Lord. According to St. Luke, the 18th chapter. Taking the 12, Jesus said to them, "See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and everything that is written about the Son of Man by the prophets will be accomplished. For he will be delivered over to the Gentiles and will be mocked and shamefully treated and spit upon. And after flogging him, they will kill him, and on the third day he will rise. But they understood none of these things. This saying was hidden from them, and they did not grasp what was said. As he drew near to Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. And hearing a crowd going by, he inquired what this meant. They told him, "Jesus of Nazareth is passing by." And he cried out, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And those who were in front rebuked him, telling him to be silent. But he cried out all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus stopped and commanded him to be brought to him. And when he came near, he asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" He said, "Lord, let me recover my sight." And Jesus said to him, "Recover your sight, your faith has made you well." And immediately he recovered his sight and followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw it, gave praise to God. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O
Thank you. that as he was approaching Jericho, a certain blind man was sitting by the road begging. He called out, saying, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus stopped and commanded he be brought to him. He asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" And he said, "Lord, I want to regain my sight." And Jesus said to him, "Receive your sight. Your faith has made you well." It's nice to see something we take for granted. Think approaching this text, initially I took it for granted. Maybe you have already today. Oh yeah, Jesus makes the blind see. But I'm blessed to get to think about it for a while, to study away at it, and what a treasure it is just to see. It's a treasure to see this morning, all of you. It's a treasure, of course, to see our Lord Christ, and what a joy it will be to see him and those who've gone before us at the great resurrection of all flesh. What a gift to see. It's a gift to see children not coloring away, but giving their attention to the Word of God. You can understand a blind man. Jesus loves him, and he sees. It's a treasure to see ushers not running around in the back talking about the game, but listening to the Word of God because they want to see Jesus. It's a treasure to see Helen this morning, who's back in the house of the saints of God after falling and suffering. What a joy to see Helen, who has come to see Jesus. If you look around, they aren't just empty faces. Pete and Petra, eager to see Jesus as you have seen him your whole life. It's a joy to see you. To see the woods, eager to be here with us, seeing what we have seen, to see visitors whom we don't know. What a joy and encouragement to see you with us around the gifts of Jesus. It's a gift to see. There's a twofold scene in this text. As you know, something is hidden from the disciples they do not see, but given to the blind man who can't see, but he does see. And Jesus says, "Your faith has made you well." What a joy for us to see what the world does not see, and to not be discouraged with all that our eyes take in, but instead to be encouraged by what faith in Christ takes in. So Jesus comes to Jericho, where the walls came tumbling down and the blind see, so that we would always continue also to see Jesus. The prophet Isaiah says, "Strengthen the weak hands, make firm the feeble knees. Say to those with anxious hearts, be strong. Don't be afraid. Behold, your God will come with vengeance. With the repayment of God, he will come and he will save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped." Prophet Isaiah, who was quite a while, hundreds of years before Jesus, speaks of Jesus as being the one who gives sight to the blind. I know a lot of lovely people, some who are very, very bright, but none of them can give sight to the blind. So how astounding is that, that Jesus heals the blind? And how astounding is this, that Isaiah speaks long before Jesus is born, long before Jesus dies and long before Jesus rises and he says, Jesus will open the eyes of the blind. It will be a sign to all who see it that the Savior of the world has come. Say to those with anxious hearts, be strong, do not be afraid. Jesus will open the eyes of the blind. So Jesus gives to the blind their sight. I don't think any of you do. I know I don't. Don't know anyone else with all of their scientific knowledge and doctrine who does. That is to say, Jesus is the one who saves. Jesus is the one who brings life to the body. Jesus is God in the flesh for us and not against us. In Jericho, not to tear down the walls and kill, but to give sight to the blind. The Savior, may our eyes see Jesus, that he is the one who redeems, and not our works and not our efforts. Thanks be to God, Jesus has done the work of redeeming the blind. So St. Paul, you might remember, was on the road to Damascus. He was killing the Christians, or leading the charge at killing the Christians anyway, holding the coats of those who chunked Stephen with stones, approving and finding the Christians. But on the road to Damascus, St. Paul was knocked off his horse by Jesus. He saw him in a dazzling light, and St. Paul became blind. He had to be led by the hand. His name was Saul, Mighty One. Then it was changed to Paul, Humble One. He couldn't see. He was blind. He met Ananias on the road called Straight. And Ananias laid his hands on Paul and encouraged Paul and baptized Paul, and scales fell from Paul's eyes, and Paul once more could see. Paul writes interesting words to the Christians in Corinth. We walk by faith and not by sight. That's good for you and for me, as we're discouraged by what we see, to hear Paul's words, who once was blind himself, and who writes with large letters, maybe he never could see very well, to say we walk by faith, not by sight. We've been given the gift of seeing lovely things, one another, and all the better, we've been given the gift of faith in our baptism and through the word, that we would walk by what we see with our ears and what we hear of Jesus who heals the blind. It's a gift to see. Now maybe you're struggling to believe and struggling to see how Jesus on the cross redeems and rescues you from the kingdom of death and delivers you to the kingdom of the Father who is in heaven. Maybe you're struggling to see it like Thomas at the resurrection, who heard from Jesus, blessed are those who believe and have not seen. But maybe you're struggling to believe, and you're a crazy evolutionist or a full-blown evolutionist. Well, you might consider then the eye. There's Michael Behe, a microbiologist quite renowned and talented, that talks about the eye. How the eye is no product of evolution, because it's a very complex mechanism with many things working together to make something which you and I know as sight. It's not something that could slowly progress over thousands and thousands of years or millions. You either see or you don't. The eye either perfectly works or it doesn't. I don't know all the parts. There's cones and there's rods and there's lenses and corneas, all those kind of things. But if you're into evolution, you might consider the eye. The eye has a creator. It's magnificent and wonderfully made that you could see your wife or the faces of your children or those you love in church and delight in them. It's no product of chance. Or furthermore, accident, like for a long time we didn't see and all of a sudden everything fell together and we did see. Well, a diesel engine doesn't fall together, as you well know. And so all the more, your eye, more wonderfully made than that, product of the Father in heaven, who has made you to delight in what you see, and who loves looking back at you with the eyes of his Son. There's plenty that don't see in the world around us, that don't consider all the wonderful things about us, and sadly think everything's a product of chaos and chance. Well, it isn't so for you, a dear child of God. You know that Jesus has died with you in mind and has risen to give you eternal life. What a gift to see. So he's talking to the 12 and he says, "Behold, we are going up to Jerusalem." That's through what they call the Valley of the Shadow of Death, the road from Jericho to Jerusalem. Jesus is walking through it, and all things that are written through the prophets about the Son of Man will be accomplished. He'll be delivered to the Gentiles and will be mocked and mistreated and spit upon. And after they have scourged him, they will kill him, and the third day he will rise again. Jesus sees the cross. Jesus is the empty tomb before it happens. And they understood none of these things. The saying was hidden from them. If you'll remember, or as you'll soon hear, we enter into Lent, and Jesus is entering into the happenings of Lent with this text. If you'll remember, when he's there before Pilate, they're screaming, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate says, "Why? What has this man done?" So you'll see today, he needs to be crucified for the blind, that they might have sight. What has this man done? He's given sight to the blind. "Crucify him, crucify him," Jesus says. That's what's before him. We just heard of Jonah, who ran away from the capital of Nineveh. He didn't want to go, and Jesus says they're going to scream, "Crucify, crucify," and yet Jesus is going there. What has this man done? Specifically, he raised Lazarus from the dead, and it angered them so much that he'd raised the dead that they put him on the cross. So he goes to the cross for the dead and the dying, because he raises the dead. The disciples did not see the blessing of the cross. They didn't see or understand Jesus' determination to be at the cross. Maybe during Lent you'll think this is a horrible accident and evil has the upper hand. Well, remember, Jesus pushes to it. He desires it. He goes through the valley of the shadow of death to die, to redeem us, that we would walk by faith and not by sight. He'll be shamefully treated and scorned. He'll be spit upon. This is mercy. It's merciful, of course, that he hears the blind man who cries and who prays, "Lord, have mercy." But when you are praying, "Lord, have mercy," see that Jesus answers your prayers by desiring this road for redemption, by going into the hands of all evil to work it for good, for you and for me. They will scourge him. They will spit upon him. They will mock him and mistreat him. The disciples could not see, but you can. This he does because he has mercy on sinners. And the world doesn't understand it, but here he pays, gives the answer for all hate and violence and trouble and evil, that we would, by the forgiveness of sins, be set free. How beautiful it is to see by faith. And so, Jesus is gracious to the man who's blind, and Jesus is gracious to us who don't really understand all things in our days or in the world about us. He doesn't say, "Oh, you don't get it, Peter? Oh, James, you're not listening today? Oh, John, you want to rain hellfire on them? I'm through with you." No, for those who do not see and those who do not understand, Jesus presses on that he might redeem them with his blood, and he might send his Holy Spirit to them that they might rightly see. Did you see the news article this morning? The hairy arm-pitted kid who was wrestling as a girl in Texas. Did you see this? You might look at it. The Texas state has girls wrestling. I guess that's somewhat unique to begin with, but in any case, in the state of Texas, the state champion of girls wrestling is a boy. I don't know. I can't even understand it anymore. He is a transitioning or transgender girl. Does that mean he's a boy or does it mean he's a girl? I don't know. I'm really confused, but anyways, a boy wrestled in the state of Texas and he's the girls wrestling champion. I don't even think the WWF could dream that up, but the world has. What we're looking at these days is just absolutely bizarre with the eye. We're ceasing to know that God has made males males and females females, and furthermore, people are praising what is going on as good and right. We walk by faith and not by sight. A newscaster this week accused girls who might be viewing naked men in their locker room as being the problem, bigoted and something like that. So you take your sweet little girl and you're supposed to tell her she's wrong, and the guy pretending to be a woman so he could get his rocks off in the girl's locker room, he's right and he's to be vindicated. What we're seeing with our eyes is just simply bizarre. In any case, know and give thanks today for the gift of Christian sight. Don't participate in this madness, but instead see with faith what your God has done for you in sending his Son. If you're taking for granted that you've been called out of darkness, and that's what all this is, into the marvelous light of the church by the work of the Holy Spirit, well then, repent. I need to. What a treasure that the Lord Jesus has given us his Spirit, so we wouldn't be confused by our eyes, but we could see the death of his Son. That Jesus has compassion on the boys who are confused and thinking they're girls. That Jesus has compassion on those who don't believe that they would believe. What a joy to see Jesus do and love like we wouldn't do and like we wouldn't love. That he would look at all the world and say, they're worthy of my redemption. The prophets have spoke of these things. Behold, we're going up to Jerusalem, and all that is written through the prophets will be accomplished. That is to say, all the scripture is about Jesus dying for sinners and rising for sinners. See that? That to Adam and Eve, the crucifixion of Jesus was spoken. And to Adam and Eve, the resurrection of Jesus was spoken. That it always has been the hope of the church, the forgiveness of sins in Christ. See that Jesus says it will happen and rejoice in what Jesus says will happen. Lift up your heads and see your redemption is coming because Jesus speaks faithfully. The crowds told him to shut up, that to cry out to Jesus for mercy was wrong. The crowds tried to keep Jesus away from the blind man, and the Christian would not be deterred. He prayed all the louder in the midst of the confusion and chaos. What a beautiful example for you and for me to pray all the louder in the midst of confusion and chaos. And what a beautiful thing that Jesus sees those who are praying and has compassion on them. Seeing is believing. You have heard before. And when you see Christ on the cross, for you, seeing is believing. The writer to the Hebrews has this to say: he has put all things under his feet, quoting the psalmist. So in church, when you receive the supper, know that Jesus has put all things under his feet. But now we don't see all things put under his feet, but we do see him who's made a little lower than the angels, Jesus, because of his suffering and death, crowned with glory and honor, that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. A twofold seeing that the Christian knows: all things subjected to him. And right now we see him crowned with glory and honor, dying for everyone, the blind included. May he grant us sight. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and minds through faith. Amen.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from whence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs, naming especially today Kay Weiss preparing for surgery, Jeremy Crawford recovering from surgery, Richard Krasinski recovering from surgery, Teresa Stevens dealing with cancer, Helen Tarter recovering from a fall, Ryan Badke's father, Bert, dealing with cancer, Heather Mallory recovering from surgery. Remember, Lord, your promise to be a rock of refuge for your baptized children. Be gracious and create in us humble and contrite hearts that we may cry out to you for mercy. Fill us with your love, grant renewal by your Holy Spirit to abide in Christ Jesus our Savior, that we may behold his glory in his holy word and sacraments. Remember all pastors in Christ, make your face shine on them, that through faithful service the eyes blind to your mercies may be open to see the salvation which is in Christ Jesus, your Son, our Lord. Remember, Lord, our nation and its leaders. Guide them that peace and prosperity, truth and justice may dwell with us. Remember those serving in our military, that they would serve with integrity and honor. Remember, Lord, the widows, orphans, lonely, downtrodden, poor, and destitute, those who are shut in and unable to attend divine service. Be a mighty fortress for them, surrounding them with your compassion and care. Fill us with loving and generous hearts to be your instruments of mercy on their behalf, and send your pastors to bring Christ to them wherever they are. Remember, Lord, the sick, those in treatment, undergoing surgery or recovering, and all in need. Comfort with your presence, sustain faith by your gracious promise, bring healing as you will and know is best. Remember, Lord, those who come to the holy altar this day to receive the medicine of immortality and the holy sacrament. Fill them with his life and love to depart in peace which surpasses all understanding. Remember, Lord, your promise to fill the wedding banquet of your Son and his bride, the church, with guests. For those who have gone before us and now rest from their labors, we give you thanks and praise. Bring us with them to the day of our Lord's glorious return, that we may all receive the eternal inheritance you have prepared for us. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen.
Welcome to all of you this morning. Pray God's rich blessing be upon you. As we prepare now to celebrate the Lord's Supper, we announce that we at Trinity do so according to the Word of God. We practice closed communion. We are careful with the gifts of God. We serve the supper to members of Lutheran Church Missouri Synod and those we're in fellowship with. If you're visiting with us today, we ask you to fill out the visitor card in pew. Not a member of the Missouri Synod and would like to participate in the sacrament here, please do talk with us about that following service or any time at all during the week. Thank you.
us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who, having created all things, took on human flesh, and was born of the Virgin Mary. For our sake he died on the cross and rose from the dead to put an end to death, thus fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you, body and soul, unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen.
That's what we think, too.